As usual, we greet those on live stream too. Some of you that we want to tell you, we enjoyed your fellowship this past week.
Amen.
Pray that it is well with your souls. Tonight we'll be in John, the 5th chapter, verses 19 through 21. This will be our 61st exposition of this book. Now, it's going to be confirmed in this text that the single most important relationship that Jesus had was with his Father, which is in heaven. We want to establish that firmly tonight. Jesus' effective ministry to the sons of God, and that's his effective ministry is to the sons of God, and his saviorhood for humanity as a whole is completely dependent upon his relationship to God.
Amen.
Jesus is going to make that more clear to us tonight. Everything Jesus is and everything Jesus does depends on his identity with God the Father. And when every tongue eventually confesses that Christ is Lord, it will be to the glory of God.
Amen.
Now, this shouldn't surprise us. The Father sent the Son, and it's the Father's will that Jesus came to do. Everything Jesus is and does depends on this identity with God and God's purpose.
Yeah.
It's because of God's intolerance of sin, total, an unabated intolerance of sin, that Jesus put it away. That's why he put it away.
Right.
It was more for God than it was for you.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
See, for a lot of people, it will have been vain.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
But for God it was not.
Yes.
It is God who reconciled us. It is God to whom Christ reconciled us. Mm-hmm. And it is God who delivered him up for us all. And it is God to whom Jesus is bringing us. See, everything depends upon this. God reconciled us, God delivered him up, God raised him up, God glorified him and exalted him. And he suffered for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God.
Amen.
So the purpose for which Jesus came into the world belongs to God. The purpose wasn't because we had need. Humanity had need for 4,000 years before he came.
Mm-hmm.
But he came to do the will of God. And Jesus, he would frequently clarify this to those he spoke to. He would mention about his relationship to God that he didn't come to restore the Jewish nation or to liberate them from the tyranny of Rome or to meet human need. Those things did not require an atoning death.
That's right.
Any angel from heaven could have done all that.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I don't mean to denigrate those things, you understand.
Uh-huh.
But what I'm showing is that when it comes to Jesus coming into the world, what we needed, what we required, wasn't enough in the earth. Earth wasn't enough to drive that. God had been helping people, protecting people, leading people, feeding people for 4 millennia before Jesus came. But there was something that had not been done, that had to be done.
Yeah.
The devil had to be neutralized and destroyed.
Amen.
Sin had to be taken away. Death had to be defeated. or the purpose of God would fall to the ground. So that's what we're going to touch on tonight. John 5, verse 19 through 21. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he, God, doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loveth the Son, and showeth him all things that he himself doeth. And he will show him greater works than these, that you may marvel. For as the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. Amen. Then answered Jesus. Now you remember, you may remember, Jesus has just finished healing a man, an impotent man, who had been impotent for 38 years. He healed him on the Sabbath day, and it set off a lot of controversy. They were talking among themselves, and Jesus answered. There wasn't any really direct question addressed to him, but he was answering their thoughts and answering their discussion. And Jesus still does this. You have to be sensitive to it. The thing about Jesus is he knew what people were thinking. He knew what people were, so he'd answer it. And that's what he's doing in this text. See, the people had a misconception of Jesus. They didn't understand him. They didn't know why he came. They didn't know why he healed on the Sabbath day, even though they'd never seen anybody else heal on any day. But Jesus will not allow people to have wrong views of him. You believe this. He will not allow people to have wrong views of him. He'll raise up somebody. Somehow he'll get through to the person, that's the wrong way to think about me. And Jesus is not going to advantage someone that thinks wrong about him. So he's straightening out their thinking here. He's going to, like I like to think of it, as evaporating their thoughts. He's just going to, he's going to obliterate the way they thought about him. Now all of this, see, people have grown accustomed to wrong thinking. They'll say something like, well, we got a right. You know, we got our rights. No, that's not right. That's not true. You're living in God's world. God made you. God bought you. You don't have right to your own thoughts. God be praised that he shared his thoughts with us so we could have some right thoughts. And we're very grateful for that. I know this may conflict with some political agenda, but like, I don't care. We're all going to stand before God, and we're not going to plead our citizenship on earth when we're there. So it's good to know these things. When it comes to the Lord Jesus Christ, man is not at liberty to kind of see him their own way and arrive at their own conclusions about him. You're not at liberty to be incorrect about Jesus. Even though none of us here would admit that we have not at some time been wrong about Jesus, we'll tell you, confess it to you, that we didn't see Jesus the right way, but when we did, through the gospel, when we did, we came to him. And we were thankful he made provision for that to take place. Now, Jesus begins his words by saying, verily, verily. Now, that is Old English, but it's because the New English hasn't caught up to the Old English. It's not as precise, it's too sloppy. See, language has become very, very sloppy. so that ha means something, or hey, you know, it's grunts and groans. But these are important words, verily, verily. They're hard to translate. So I'll give you what some of the translations translate it. Most assuredly, that's a New King James Version. New American Standard says, I tell you the truth. The NIV says, it says, I tell you the truth. The New American Standard says, truly, truly. New Revised Standard Version says, very truly. Holman's Bible says, I assure you. Jewish Bible says, yes, indeed. The New Way Version says, amen, amen. God's Word Bible says, I can guarantee this truth. The other version says, this is basic truth. I tell you the solemn truth. In all truth, I tell you. I assure you most solemnly, I tell you. Why does Jesus have to talk this way? Why does he have to say to people, this is the truth? Because people don't know the truth. They don't understand the truth as God defines truth. Jesus could have just said it and let it go. But it says he buttresses it, verily, verily, two verilies. In fact, these words, verily, verily, are found 25 times. They're all in the Gospel of John. And they're said a few more times, verily is said. He's stating the certainty of a thing. Now, there, life can get so you want only a certain word. You've got to have a word that's certain. If you're in a burning building, you don't know the way out, you want some verilies. You want the word of escape has got to be certain. It can't be vague. Uh-huh. See? You've got some illness that is diagnosed as terminating in death, and only some specialist knows about how to treat this. You want a verily. You want someone that knows what they're talking about. But I am confounded that when it comes to religion and when it comes to faith and when it comes to the church and when it comes to Christ, a lot of people don't think this way. Yeah. I want somebody who knows the truth. See, they don't seem to. So Jesus talks this way. So you know this.
Generation, the church people seem to have come to the place where they think nobody knows the truth.
Yeah.
It's just up for grabs. It's just whatever,
it is
whatever
true.
Anybody's opinion is. Mm. One's as good as another.
I think there's a reason for this, Brother Gene. I think when it comes to faith in that, people have been disappointed so much that they kind of think nobody has a straight thing to say.
Why, if you speak with some certainty,
know it all.
Mm-hmm. they wonder.
What
did
I hear about
this guy anyway?
Yeah, not sure.
Of course,
sure
they wondered the same about Jesus. This crap.
Yeah. It was the same way. Yeah, he spoke. He didn't. He just what he said. It was invariable. You couldn't tweak it in any way. You couldn't add something or take away from it. You didn't have to doctor it up and make it palatable. It just stood just like it was stated. It stood.
Amen.
And you're right. People are not accustomed to this. At least not in religion. Now, there are certain fields now. If you're an engineer and you're building a structure, now you don't want someone talking to you that has an unsure word. They got to be certain about it.
Yes.
But men have been accustomed to a lack of specificity in matters pertaining to God. It's just kind of unsure, you know. That's just what you think, sort of thing. But Jesus is emphasizing that what I say is the truth. You can hang your soul on this.
Amen.
You can suspend your hope on this. If Jesus is saying, if you believe what I say, it'll take you home all the way.
Yes, amen.
At no point will it fail you. At no point will it fail you. Verily.
Yeah.
Verily. And here's what he says. The Son can do nothing of himself. Son, capital S.
Yeah.
Other versions say the Son can do nothing on his own. Or the Son can do nothing of his own accord. Or he's not able to do anything himself. Or he cannot do anything from the will of himself. Or the Son is able to do nothing of himself or of his own accord. That's some statement. That is some statement. This is the Son we're talking about now. Son of God we're talking about. He says, I can't. You want to know how far Jesus came to save us?
Yeah.
He came this far. Where he couldn't do anything on his own. This is what we're talking about, one who created the worlds. We're talking about that one. Who was in the beginning with God and was God. That's who we're talking about. But when he came to earth, it was a different situation. I can't do anything on my own. That's quite a statement. This is part of what's involved in the Word becoming flesh and dwelling among us. This Jesus consented to do this. This is what's involved in Jesus humbling himself, as Philippians 2:8 says, or being made the seed of David according to the flesh, or being made a little lower than the angels. Hebrews 2:9. This is what's involved in this. Now, it may be touching and sentimental to think of a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. That may make a rather attractive and pretty scene. But when you know what's involved in that, it ceases to be a pretty little scene. Jesus entered the world. He couldn't think. He couldn't talk. He couldn't reason. He had no capacities of expression except to cry. I don't know whether he did that. That's what's it. That's what. See, people have made kind of a folksy thing out of the birth of Christ, but it is not a folksy thing. It is the most remarkable condescension that any personality ever underwent. There has never been any personality in heaven, in earth, or under the earth who stooped that low.
Amen.
Nobody. Son can do nothing of himself. Why did he do that? That's what it took to save us. We had to have somebody identify who I was identified with us. We didn't need like a Superman to swoop in and save us. We needed to have someone who walked about and looked like we do and were subjected to the things we're subjected to, and in that capacity fulfilled the will of God perfectly. That's what we needed.
Amen.
So that's why Jesus said the Son, not a son, the Son can do nothing of himself. Now, this is just how I think now, what I'm telling you. This is my thought. If Jesus couldn't do anything of himself, I can't think that I can do something of myself.
Yeah.
That I'm tempted at times to do this? Yes, but I have to subordinate that.
Yes.
That has to be subordinated.
Yes.
All trouble, whether it's personal or social, our country, all trouble comes from somebody trying to do it their way. All difficulty, all schism, all sectarianism, all church fights, all disagreements, they all are because somebody wants their way. All right, now we go to Jesus. He's the premier man.
Yes.
He says, I can't do anything on my own.
Amen.
And if you will, this is a lifetime thing now. Nobody else can do this for you. If you will link up with Jesus and maintain that connection so that his life is in you, you will stop wanting your own way. I can guarantee it. And I don't know of anyone that's perfectly achieved that, but they're making some progress. If you want to make some people mad, just tell them to do something they don't want to do. I'm showing you that ingrained in the human nature is this desire for self-will. But Jesus, he said, I can't do anything on my own.
So it proves that it's right for God to demand perfect obedience from men.
Oh, yes.
Jesus came and proved that not only was it possible, it was the right thing.
That's right.
And that when you set out to do it, you will receive grace. The sinful human nature reacts exactly like Satan did in this topic.
That's right.
What he does.
That's right. See, this is not unreasonable if you can see it. God made you, and then God bought you. So you're twice God's. And God's not, he's seeking your good. This is a good God, which is a good God. So we're not talking about somebody like the devil who tries to harm you. This is a good God we've got here. And that, thank God we owe our life to him and not to the devil. See? So it's a good thing. Then he continues, he said, he only did what he saw the Father doing. He couldn't do anything on his own. Now, not everybody can see what God's doing. Yeah. Tornado happens, tsunami happens, earthquake happens, war breaks out, and it becomes a little difficult to see what God's doing. But Jesus saw. And he only did what he saw the Father doing. What do you mean? What he fit in with what God was. If he saw what God was doing, it was like a river. He got in that river. Got in that mainstream, what he was doing. I only do what I see the Father doing. John 5:36 says, and then he says, I only say what the Father's taught me to say.
Yeah.
And he was perfect in this. See,
amen.
I want desperately to do what I see God doing and say what God says to say, but I must admit that I sense my deficiency in being able to see this like I want to see it. But God has given us his Holy Spirit to assist us in this discernment.
Yes.
And once you see what God's doing, you become involved in it. Yes, Sister June.
Whenever Jesus came and humbled himself, we see what mankind was really created to be like. Like in the garden.
Yeah.
God told the man to till the ground and to keep the garden. And I'm sure he imparted a lot of knowledge to him. People get the idea when you say, I only do what I see the Father doing and say what I hear the Father saying, that it's robotical. But it has to do with the intimate knowledge of God himself. And Jesus, like he received a commandment from the Father to lay his life down and to take it again. That didn't mean he waited for every little micro thought. He knew what that meant. And he worked that out. There's a whenever the apostles, this doing, saying what the Father says, we can see probably the most precise image in men and the apostles receiving inspiration, the prophets receiving inspiration of God in a more direct sense and saying what God said.
Amen.
But this is a great thing. This is not being led around by your nose. This is being conformed to the image of God so you can receive these things and discern these things and operate within that context without violating the person or will of God.
Mm-hmm. You remember there in Romans 12 it says that, present your bodies a living sacrifice unto God, wholly acceptable, which is your reasonable service, and you're told to do it that you might know what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So we're not talking about seeing something that runs against the grain, so to speak. One of the benefits of being saved or reconciled or justified or born again or however you want to say it, one of the benefits is that the things of God become pleasant and good to you. And you're able to see that if God does it, it's good.
Yeah, amen. Yes.
And then you do likewise, of course. I only do, say, whatever the Father does, our text says it this way. What things soever he does, these also the Son does. That's what I do. If I see what God's doing, so he'd come into a city, if there were people in that city that God was going to have mercy on, Jesus had mercy on. If there were people in that city that God was rebuking, Jesus would rebuke them. See? If God had passed by that city, he passed by the city. See, this is the way this Jesus, but he had to see what God was doing. As a man, he had to see it. We're not talking about now Jesus functioning as God. He was God, but he sheathed.
That's right.
His deity.
Yep.
Put it in the sheath. And so he perceived, oh, God's going to go to Samaria. So that he headed for Samaria. God's going to meet a woman at a well. See, this is how Jesus lived. And to your full capacity, this is how you should live.
Yeah.
To the fullest measure you can. And you'll be made very keenly aware of the fact that God's got to be doing more than you see. I mean, you'll be stricken with that. But don't get bogged down in what you can't see. Get involved in what you can see, and God will increase your vision.
The angels, the holy angels, didn't have any problem with Lucifer. They there was war in heaven, but they summarily just cast him out. Yeah. But now man hasn't had this kind of victory. Fallen men, I mean. Satan has triumphed over everyone except this man.
This man.
That he couldn't get him to do anything that his father wasn't doing.
Yeah.
And you know he tried.
Well, he tried,
if he could have just got him to do something.
40 uninterruptible days.
Yeah.
You know, we say that Jesus was the exact representation of God. And that's true. It kind of gets away from you, though, when you say it like that.
I know.
If you say it like you said it, that Jesus went everywhere God would have went.
That's right.
He spoke just like God would. He said the same things that God would have said. And picking out people whom he healed and spoke to and everything is exactly the way God would have done
it. Yes.
And so that really now, you can get a hold of that.
Now this transforms the reading of the Gospels.
Yeah, uh-huh.
See, now Jesus is in heaven now. Right? So now our assignment is even higher now. But we have in the Gospels how he lived, how he reacted, where he went, what he avoided, what he couldn't tolerate, what he did tolerate. It's all in there, but you want to pick up on this. You're just not reading a historical account. God deliver us from reading like history. This is selected excerpts of Christ's life that are designed to teach you how he lived when he was here, to convince you it is possible to live that way.
Amen. That's right.
Here's someone who did it.
Yes.
So seeing that the Savior humbled himself, always doing the Father's will, I mean, what soul is there that would insist on their own way? Now, we're tempted to do so. We don't deny. We're not angels here tonight.
Yeah.
We understand that, but sin has to become unreasonable to you. And when you think of the way Jesus lived, it helps sin to become unreasonable. And sin is the assertion of self, the gratification of self, see? And so the life of Jesus brings with it hope, because he was one of us, see? He was one of us. And he shows us how God is willing to work with one of us, see? He continues, the Father loveth the Son. Now this same statement is made in John 3:35 also. The Father loves the Son. And John says, and has given all things into his hand. He loves the Son. In Gethsemane, that prayer he prayed on the eve of his betrayal, he said, I have declared unto them, his disciples, thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. See, this fact of the Father loving the Son, this is a big matter in Scripture. God referred to Jesus as my beloved Son. We would say the Son of my love. Referring to his imminent death, Jesus said, therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I might take it up again.
Yes, amen.
So God loved him because he did that.
Yes.
God loved Jesus because he laid down his life so he could take it up again.
Amen.
I'm showing that God's love is discreet.
Yeah.
See, men have some awful strange views of the love of God, but I want to establish what kind of love this is. Notice the things that confirms that God loves the Son. Our text says he shows him all things that he's doing, right?
Yeah.
That's how he confirmed the love. He showed him what he was doing. And he'll show him greater works. See, that confirms that he loved him. He's given all things into Jesus' hands.
Yeah.
That confirms he loves him. He loves him because he laid down his life that he might take it up again. See, all of these relate to the role of the Son of God in the removal of sin.
Yeah.
The destruction of the devil, the reconciliation of the world, or the redemption of man, it all relates to that.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Lock, stock, and barrel.
Mm-hmm.
All of that is irrevocably tied to God making everything new.
Yeah.
Starts by making people new.
Yeah.
He's going to make the earth new.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to make the heavens new. But in order for this to be done, he had to have a representative on earth that would do his will without flaw.
Yeah, amen.
That would take care of the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
The enemy had to be destroyed. Nobody, after 4,000 years, nobody could even put a bump on Satan's head, so to speak.
Yeah,
and he needed someone who could take away sin, and he found it in the Son. And he loved the Son because the Son was doing what he wanted him to do. Now I understand you could take this too far with human reasoning, but there's got to be some way in which you think of God's love this way. When I'm doing what God wants me to do, he loves me. I mean, you've got to get to the point where you think like this, and don't let anyone tell you when you're not doing God's will, God loves you anyway. Don't
yeah.
You're going to have a hard time proving that.
Yeah, that's right.
Very difficult. Because
yeah.
I don't know how you'd avoid God having to love Satan if that's the truth.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because Satan was once there, yeah, where God right. is.
Yep.
And anyone that says God has any kind of love for Satan, they just are what we used to call airheads. They have cranial cavity. This isn't so. See, God's love is discretionary. Jesus is showing you as discretionary. Yes.
When I first came into the Lord, that's what I was taught, you know, and I think that made it very difficult for me to, you know, get a grasp on things, really, because I was taught, Jesus is going to love you no matter what.
Mm-hmm. So. It's not that a person wants to be a libertine-like, but that lens encourages thinking too low.
That's right.
That's the failure. It like skews the thinking. It pitches it off center just a little bit. Mm-hmm. So that now when you get down to the hard things of life where you really need God, your thinking's way off here.
That's right. Yep.
In left field. Yeah. Yes, Brother Justin.
You have to restrain your flesh, and because I know that there's people that they teach that, like Judas, he was one of the 12, right? And so God still loves Judas just the way he is. But see, how are you going to deny ungodliness and worldly lust with that kind of a...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's contrary to that.
Yeah. See, the fact that God loves the Son destroys that kind of thinking.
Yeah, uh-huh.
If God's nature is to love everybody, he wouldn't have to set his love on his Son. Just the fact that his Son entered in the world, it would automatically... But see, he set his love deliberately on the Son.
That's why it's important that, and this is manifest the love of God, that he sent his Son.
Yeah.
God's attention is directed to the manner of love, which God loves.
That's right.
You can't direct your attention to the cross and think, well, I'm just fine the way I am. Because you see the cost of what it took to save you.
That's right.
So you see the benevolence. Right. You see the will for you to be saved. Well, you have that, but... You can't look at that and then conclude, well, it doesn't matter. It did matter. Look at what it cost.
That's right.
Amen. Now, when we think of God's love, the highest expression of that love is toward the Son.
That's right.
Now, that has to be seen.
Yeah.
The highest expression of God's love is toward his Son. It's unmitigated. That's unmodified.
Yes.
It's there's no qualifiers put on it. There's qualifiers put on us.
That's right.
But there's none put on the Son. So that's right. You've got to think of God's love that way. Yes. The highest expression of God's love is his love for his Son,
Amen.
Who is our Savior.
That's yes. right. And only
as we are associated with him,
that's right.
will we be able to experience the manifestation
yes.
of that.
Amen. If we follow the Son and obey the Son and live for the Son, God's love will be known. If we don't, the love of God will be theoretical.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
You may talk about it, jabber about it, write about it, but you won't know about it.
Yeah. Amen.
That's how you got to view these things. So you don't have to make some grandiose statement about the love of God that you can't support.
Yeah.
But this we can support. Mm. The preeminent revelation of God's love is his love for his Son.
That's right.
You have access to that love, experiential access to that love, by virtue of your relation to Christ Jesus.
That's right. Amen.
That's what gives you the access. Now he says the Father loves the Son, and he shows him all things that he himself doeth, and he shows him everything he's doing. Shows it to the Son. Quite a statement. Here's what God's going to do, was he shows it to the Son. Why? Because the Son is going to execute it.
Yeah, amen.
In the earth. Now, when speaking of God's love toward man, we don't read statements like this. These like unqualified kind of statements. When you talk about God's love for man, we read things like, shall be loved of my Father, John 14:21. For the Father himself loveth you because you have loved me and believed I came out from God. whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. See, I'm showing you that there's, when it comes to men, there's their conditions attached to it. He so loved. He hast, past, loved. That loved us. That means he did something that demonstrated the love versus having a personal attachment. He so loved us, and he first loved us. See, all of those, there's like conditions and the times and seasons associated with this. But when it comes to Christ, we don't read of those kind of associations. Other than the one, he loved me because I laid down my life that I might take it up again. But he, his involvement in God's will was buttressed by God's love. See, and if God, you must think of God's love like this. If you are experiencing God's love, you will be able to do what he requires you to do. That's how you've got to think of it. And you point back to Jesus as a proof of that. Now, I don't want to press this matter too far because you can get off into speculation. But the love of the Father, the love that the Father has for the Son preceded his entrance into the world. This is what like sets it apart. In his Gethsemane prayer, John 17:24, he refers to the love which I had before the before the foundation of the world. So see, that sets Jesus up apart from us. Now notice how this marvelous love has provoked God to do. To show Jesus what he's doing. I mean, this Moses knew some things that God were doing. See, he showed the prophets some things he was doing. But Jesus, he shows me all things that he's doing. That's marvelous. So if you want to know the will of God, you nestle up to Jesus. Get close to him.
That's exactly what I was thinking earlier when speaking about being able to see what the Father is doing, is that Christ is the express image of the Father. Mm-hmm. And so when we have this one as the mediator of the covenant, then we can see the Father's will in him.
Amen.
And that's where we can enter into doing it ourselves.
Amen. Amen. Now, I must confess to you that there are some complications that this brings on. You've got to learn to handle him discreetly and for the glory of God, but sometimes you will detect other people who are going contrary to the will of God. And there's really nothing you can really do about it. Maybe you can sound a word of warning or something, but you kind of see where this is headed because maybe you were on that path yourself. Maybe you went down that path yourself, so you know, I know this is not a good... All right, now put yourself in the shoes of Jesus. He saw that in everybody.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
But it didn't deter him, see?
Yeah.
So when you see, even if it's like a mass falling away, you can't let it get you off.
That's right.
You can't become so occupied with that departure that you neglect the love of God yourself.
Yes.
And that's lived out in Jesus. See, Jesus, that's sometimes he would just leave the multitudes. He'd just leave them and go up into a mountain. Why did he do that? See, he saw. You can only have so much contact with the world.
Amen. That's right.
And it begins to take from you. Uh-huh. And you've got to be able to detect when that is and be able to retreat to a hiding place. And if I got good news for you there, God has established a man for a hiding place. Isaiah 32, a man, so you can actually retreat to Jesus right in the middle of a bunch of activity and a lot of society. You can retreat into the safety zone. Yes.
You keep talking about, I've been hearing more and more lately how it doesn't matter what you do, God is going to take you back to himself. And just this week, I heard there was someone talking about Hosea and how God illustrated how no matter how bad you are, He'll always take him back to yourself, and that Hosea was to go buy Gomer back when she went committing her whoredoms. But I thought of Jude. It says, "Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life."
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So there's this exhortation given. Keep yourselves in the love of God.
Yeah.
And look for the ability to do it that's going to come. I'm telling you this is what we've went over. With the command comes the strength to perform that command. So keep yourselves in the love of God. I also thought no man shall be able to pluck them out of my hand. No one can pluck you from Christ's hand, but you can walk out. And this is the same type of thing, I think. Keep yourselves in the love of God, but you can lose that access you have.
Yeah, see, the secret to it all, it's got to be lifted out of the realm of theory. It's 1 Peter 1:5 spells it out. It says, "Who are kept by the power of God through faith." That's the part that people tend to neglect. And I must honestly say that a lot of people neglect this. Only neglect it because that's what they've been said, been told. It's not a personal preference. It's not like that. They don't understand. And so some people have caused others to go astray by them trusting in God independently of faith. And the truth of the matter is, you can't trust God independently of faith.
Yeah. Amen. I think Paul wrote that the love of Christ constraineth us.
Yeah, yeah. It does.
That's the kind of thing that's talking about.
Yeah. Again, if a person loses his way in this, you go back to Jesus and get your bearings with Jesus. It says the Father loved the Son, and see how Jesus reacted to that, and that will spell it out for you, how this works. God's love is tied to a person, but when a person's wandering way out here in Neverland, I mean, Jesus didn't do that. Jesus did not do that, not even when he was 2 or when he was 12 or any other age. He never did that. So when a person's wandering, we don't have a keeping message to deliver to them. Whether God keeps or not, we're not saying God can't keep them. We're saying that's not what they're supposed to hear. They're supposed to hear, like, repent. Make straight paths for your feet.
Yes.
Lest that which is lame be turned out of the way. Yes.
A couple of thoughts on the love of God. And we've said a lot there, and there is a lot said in church circles about the love of God and who God loves and how God loves. And this text opens the fact that not all of the love of God is the same.
In other words, the
love that God has for the Son is a deeper, however you want to put it, deeper, higher, closer, more intimate, more profound. But there is a sense in the John 3:16 that God loved the world. There's a level of love that is, it was a provision
that's
given
right.
to everyone.
That's right.
And so when we talk about things that are set, you know, God loves everyone. Well, God is love, and He so loved the world that He gave, and Jesus took away the sin of the whole world. But then there's a difference between love your enemies and husbands love your wife.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, this provisional love. You notice when it speaks about God loving the world, it's always past tense. The Bible, nowhere does the scripture say God loves the world. And the reason it says He loved the world is in the death of Christ, that was driven by his love. His judgment of Christ was driven by his hatred of sin. Okay? The fact that he made him a curse. His judgment. See, God hates sin.
That's right.
But he made him, he loved, he provided for a way out.
Yeah, that's right.
But God is not attracted to sinners. I mean, how many more evidences than you need than Cain and the world and Noah's day and Sodom and Gomorrah and Jerusalem and on and on and on? But only God could do something about having an aversion to sin and yet wanting to save sinners. See, God was able to do something about that situation. And thank God, you never want to lose your sensitivity to that. Now he's showing me, the Father shows me all things that he himself does. And then he says, and he will show him greater works than these.
Yeah.
Now the miracles Jesus did, he went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. These were marvelous works by the finger of God. He cast out demons. These were marvelous displays of divine power, but there are some greater works.
Yeah.
There are some greater works. These things were all impossible. I understand that. Raising the dead, healing lepers, healing the sick, and so forth. But they're not in the same category as defeating death.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or destroying the devil. Or justifying sinners. Or causing one to be born again. See, they're not in the same category. All those things were done on earth, and they were done by someone who was on earth. But what these greater works, they're legislated from heaven, and they're of a higher order. Yes.
I like your article that you posted earlier today, where people are saying that God doesn't work miracles anymore. Well, if he doesn't work physical miracles anymore, then how could he work miracles?
Yeah.
How could these new births and new hearts and new minds?
Yeah.
You remember what happened at Pentecost? Mm-hmm. It was miraculous happenings took place there. But they were to the same class as what had happened. The people among whom Jesus worked all these miracles were the people that called for his crucifixion. None of those miracles changed anybody.
Yeah, that's right.
They changed their fleshly from leper to non-leper and impotent to walk, and they changed their physical status, but they didn't change their hearts.
Yeah.
They didn't change their natures, because the same people were the people that called for Christ to be crucified. But what Jesus, with these greater works, the people involved in these works, they don't do things like that. And he says, greater works will he show them, show you that ye may marvel. I'm for restoring a marveling religion. I mean, let's face it, there's not a lot of things done these days that cause people to marvel. But God can work so that people marvel. They are full of astonishment at what God does. The miracles that Jesus did, which no one else did or could do, could be seen with a naked eye. But the greater things, they can't be seen with a naked eye. They can be seen, but not with the naked eye. They're invisible. And they're greater. See, I think I could say this, that the greater something is from God, the more invisible it is. The more it's visible, It's a lower form of greatness. It's still great, can't be done by anybody else, but it's a lower form of greatness. And he has this this explanation. For as the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. Now remember, this is he's answering this multitude that objected to him healing that impotent man.
Yeah.
Yes, Judah.
Before you get too far away from the point of greater works, you said the more invisible it is, the greater it becomes. And there's a way in which it's greater because of our participation in it. How's this for the power of indestructible life? Jesus destroyed death by succumbing to it. He died and defeated Satan, his hosts, death itself. That was in his death. And now he reigns forever at the right hand of God. We are able to participate in that. And we're given life because of that greater work. So it's more than something we can watch and be amazed at, because we're involved in what God is doing in this work. That makes it greater on a whole other scale.
Yeah. Now I would say this, that Jesus didn't succumb to death. He gave his life up. See?
Yeah.
It's just a technicality, but it's just good to good to express it right. Yes, yeah, so these greater works do involve God's working with men. That's what we're talking, as Judah indicated. As the Father. Now, Jesus always talk about his Father, as that he did things as the Father did them. 10 times Jesus uses the phrases as the Father or as my Father. He took his work and he compared it to the Father, as the Father. The action of Jesus reflected the manner of the Father. Well, if you can see this redemption provides for this kind of expression from you that is as the Father. Now, we know this is true because Jesus said, be ye therefore perfect even as your Father. See, there it is perfect in heaven. Mm-hmm. Here's again, be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake. See, trace it back to God's kind. And again, he that has entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works as God did from his. So there, the validity of a work is determined by whether it's the kind of work God does or not.
Amen. Yes.
If you can see this is quite liberating. If you can see this, it saves you from wading through a lot of things.
He was the express image of the Father.
That's right.
And the church is a representation of him.
That's right.
So it would act in accord with this.
That's right.
Yeah.
We're not. Jesus was a perfect replica.
That's right. Yeah.
We're not perfect replicas, but
someday we will.
Someday we will be. Now it says that of the Father, he raised up the dead and quickeneth them. For as the Father raises the dead and gives life to them, the New King James Version says. Now, raising the dead refers to the body being raised. Mm-hmm. Quickening the dead refers to the spirit being enlivened. See, resurrection is a twofold thing in resurrection. Okay. The body's raised from the grave, and a redeemed spirit enters into the body. Yeah. Now, God does both of those things. As he raised up the dead and quickeneth them.
Yeah.
The body has come from the graves, the spirit inhabit the bodies. Mm-hmm. Now, what salvation is all about is so your spirit will fit into that body.
Yeah, amen.
Everybody's going to receive a resurrected, incorruptible, immortal body.
Amen.
Everybody. Mm-hmm. Judas is going to get one. Everybody's getting a body that can't sin.
Yeah.
Now, if a person's got a spirit that's all it can do, now you get a little idea of where the fire, worm dieth not and the fire's not quenched.
Right.
Here's a people in hell will not be able to do anything they want to do.
Yes, that's right.
Amen. They'll be totally without any, this new body will not be able to carry it out.
Yeah.
and it will not be able to be destroyed. Mm-hmm. And they're going to be trapped in it with all these deviant desires.
Yes.
Fearful thing to fall into the hands yes. of a living God. Sir, in the resurrection, spiritual resurrection, there's a resurrection of capacities to serve God, called a new man. That's a resurrection. That's to the spiritual resurrection what the body coming out of the grave is to the body resurrection. Then the Holy Spirit inhabits that capacities and empowers them, so the capacities can be used to honor God.
Yes.
That's the spiritual resurrection. Mm-hmm. He raised up the dead and quickened them. Now the Son says, just that way. Even so, just that way, the Son quickens whom He will.
Yeah.
Whom He will. Now, this can't be said of any preacher, no matter how potent, not even if it's Paul.
Yeah.
He quickens whom He wills. That can't be said of any man.
Yeah.
But it can be said of Jesus.
Amen.
There's some people Jesus wants to quicken.
Yes. Amen.
He quickens whom He will. All right, you got a person has to deal with this now.
Yeah.
Whom He will. Does Jesus want to save everybody? Well, there's a sense in which that's true. Yeah, there's a sense in which that's true, but not this sense that we're talking about here now.
Yeah.
He quickens whom He will. See, there's an approach to what's called evangelism that presumes that anyone and everyone who respond to the message has been delivered and saved. They go through the routine, whatever the routine is, you know, and they assume they're in. Well, we prefer to, if you're going to assume something, well, it is better to assume that. But the truth of the matter is that before anybody gets in, they got to pass the Son test. And that's completely out of our hands now. This is completely out of our hands. But this is what's happening in the background. Nobody gets in that the Son doesn't want in.
Yeah.
And nobody is kept out that the Son wants to bring in.
Yeah.
See, that's the way. He's got power. Says it just like the Father does whatever He wants.
Uh-huh.
I do whatever I want.
Yeah.
All right, now you got to learn to think backwards.
Mm-hmm.
If you're in, Jesus wanted you in.
Yeah.
So you got to think that. You got to think this way.
Mm-hmm.
You don't say, "Well, I sure hope, boy, I hope what I did was right."
Yeah.
Can't think that way.
That's right. Yeah, it says that his winnowing fan is in His hand.
That's right. Yeah.
You can see this, can't
you?
You take these facts and you reason concerning your own conversion. You reason.
That's right.
If Jesus is precious to you, if you're believing on Christ, you're trusted in Christ, you have no doubts about Christ.
Yes.
See, that's, you got to trace that back to He was willing.
Amen.
Now let that burn up your doubts.
Yes. Now you can go, you reason backwards.
If I'm in, it's because Jesus wanted me in, and if Jesus wants me in, it's because the Father wants me in, because He doesn't do anything that the Father
doesn't want
done.
That's exactly right.
So, God's orchestrating, like you've already said, Jesus is executing His will.
Yeah, now listen, surely everybody knows this, but maybe someone doesn't. When you live and move and have your being in God, or you're walking by faith, or you're living in the Spirit, you have this absolute preference for Christ.
Yeah.
If anything comes between you and Christ, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make any difference if it's your mother, father, brother, sister, wife, children, louses, lands. Jesus talked about this. It doesn't make any difference what it is. If it stands between you and Christ, here's a song we used to sing, "I'm going through, Jesus. I'm going through." And you pay this, but if you're not living for Christ, you can't even think this way.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
you will end up invariably being a compromiser. And you compromising makes you weak. It creates holes in the fence and vulnerable places in the wall. So when you read, Jesus says this, I quicken whom I will. If you know you've been enlivened toward God, Jesus did that because he wanted to do it. Amen. He didn't have to be talked into doing it. He wanted to do it. He dispatched the Holy Spirit to empower you to do whatever was required. Amen. And you base your faith solidly on that, see? Amen. That I'm that the will of God, that's what you're trusting in, the will of God, not in your will. You're the will of God, you're trusting in. He made you willing in the day of his power.
Amen. That's right.
Amen. Never theorize. You never want to theorize about things like this.
Yeah.
What if, and does that mean, and all this. That's all from the plains of oh no. These things are written so we can base our confidence on them, so we can speculate about. You're not saying that. Well, what Jesus was saying was exactly what he meant.
Yeah.
I quicken whom I will.
Yeah.
Father gave me. He said,
yes.
Even so, I quicken whom I,
Amen.
Whom I will. So the judgment and decisions of the Lord Jesus cannot be circumvented or ignored. If there's a group of ladies over in Macedonia and where the gospel hasn't gone over there yet, and they're praying by a riverside over there, and Jesus says, I got my mind set on that group of women over there. So the Holy Spirit, they gave a dream to Paul. Paul dreams a dream. Sees a vision. He sees a man over in Macedonia, a man saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. He reports that to the brethren. They thought about it. Said, this must be God calling us to go to Macedonia. So they packed up and went to Macedonia, and they got over there. Didn't find a man. Say a man, he saw a man. Didn't see a man, but they found some women praying by a riverside. It was Lydia. She's converted, her household's converted. That church of Philippi started as a result of that. One of the most ideal churches in the scripture that from the beginning stuck with Paul.
Amen.
It was all orchestrated from heaven.
Amen.
All of it. When they tried to go up into Asia, remember? Holy Spirit said, no. No. Not yet. They went into Asia later, but not yet. Then they said to go to Bithynia? No. Blocked the way. Why? The kingdom of God is driven by the will of God, and Jesus is executing the will of God. But you've got to be in sync with Jesus to be involved in the will. That's why there's such a thing as growing up into Christ in all things. Ephesians 4:15. Growing up into Christ in all things. That's why. So if Jesus wants to use somebody, you're available.
Amen.
Wants to use a whole congregation, is available, see? It's available. That's what it's all about. So what Jesus said in this text defines for us some of the involvements of him being the foundation. See, it says he's other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. All right, being the foundation, that's what we've been talking about here. That he quickens whom he will, see? Father makes known to him whatever he's doing. I only do what I see the Father doing. I only say what the Father teaches me. That's part of being the foundation. We're seeing here part of what's involved in him being a cornerstone, establishing the direction everything takes. And why? This is why we're joined to the Lord. That's why. It's because he's the one God's using to direct the whole project. It's why we become his sheep, see? Sheep of his pasture. It's why we're given his spirit. This is why all these things exist, because all of these make it possible for Christ to direct the church like the Father directed him. That's how it works. That's how it works, brother. Jesus directs us like the Father directed him, but just as he had to live unto God, and not let anything interrupt his access to God, so we can't let anything interrupt our fellowship with Christ. He called us into the fellowship of his dear Son. We don't want anything to interrupt with that.
Amen.
Now, it'll upset some people, what you do, but then you can't let that bother you. You just look them right square in the eye and say, now you judge whether we ought to obey God rather than man. That's what Peter did, and they ordered him what to do. He said, oh, we're not going to do what you said. Yeah. You're the religious authorities, the rulers of the temple. Yeah, we admit that. We're not doing what you said. Uh-huh. You judge for yourselves. Shouldn't we obey God rather than men? Just say that to people.
Yeah. Yeah.
People ask you to compromise, say that to them. Open up your mouth and tell them that. You're not doing this because of some personal vendetta you got against them, or because you don't like them personally. That didn't nothing to do with this. The king has spoken.
Yeah.
And we're going where he said to go, and we're going to do what he said to do, just like Jesus did.
Yeah.
He set the tone for us.
Amen.
You'll be blessed for it. And there are some people who will come to Christ because you did that.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
You'll reach reachable people.
Yes.
Because you had that kind of posture.
Amen.
And if you have something else you'd like to add tonight, yes, Brother Jim.
The ironic thing about this teaching that about God's love, it'll get quite a rise out of people.
Why not?
Typically people that are living further from God. But the ironic thing is, it's not that we're saying, or that God would be saying, I won't love you.
No.
Mm-hmm. Whosoever will may come.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
So where they see it as an exclusivity, that's a ploy of the devil to,
Amen.
To weaken God's love.
Yeah.
But the thought that I've got is how much more special it is for the people of God to know that he has a special love for those that love him.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to a broad love of everybody, regardless of what they do or what their affections are, then his love for me is like theirs. It doesn't seem right. But in this teaching about him loving Jesus and their agreement, he loves us as we love him, and that strengthens that love both ways. It's a phenomenal teaching once it's understood.
Amen.
Yes.
A person can reason this way. If God so loved the world by providing a universally applicable salvation, then there can be no question about his love toward those who accept that. See, so there could be no question about that, because he provided a total remedy.
Amen.
Some religion teaches that he didn't. It wasn't total. It was just provided for a few. But it was a global, because it had to, salvation had to extend as far as sin.
Amen.
See, you couldn't have sin extending way out here and salvation extended halfway.
That's right.
It had to reach as far. What Jesus did had to reach as far as what Adam did.
Yes, amen.
And it does.
Amen.
It reaches as far as Adam's sin reached, and it touched every born person.
Amen.
And that's how effective Christ's death is. Anywhere, everywhere, whoever comes to Christ, he will in no wise turn away.
Amen.
Well, I thank God for
that.
Yes, amen.
It's about what I was going to say. It's better to focus on the inclusive nature of this than its exclusive nature.
Uh-huh.
Because we can attain God's love. We can be a part of that.
Amen.
Instead of, no. You know, it might seem like we say that when we refute the doctrine of unconditional love. It might sound harsh.
Yeah.
But it's not harsh, because if you really want it, you can have it.
Yeah.
We're talking about experiential. Yeah. When with the discretionary part is on the experiential.
Uh-huh.
Experiencing the love. And act the love of God. If it's not experienced, it's like, so what, you know?
You're talking about love had to go to extent, like sin. Now, the same thinking, that for all have sinned, so God provided a way for all men
right.
to
to be saved. He, like you said a while ago, he loved man because he provided a way out for every man.
Romans 5:15 through 19 develops this. It says there's actually in the land there's only two men. So far as God's concerned, there's only two men. Adam and Christ.
That's right.
In Adam, all were made sinners. In Christ, they're made righteous. See, and he draws several parallels at Romans 5:15 through 19. There's only really two men. There's two family trees.
Yes.
All there is. And the Adam side has been written off.
Yeah, that's right. 100%.
Mm-hmm. The Christ side has been written on 100%.
Amen.
Yeah, think how big the family is already. Yeah, right. Through history, think how big the family is already.
Yeah.
Yes, Sister Ada.
Right before this, when the Jews were angry because Jesus made himself equal with God in his statements. And really, you could view verses 19 through 46 as sort of a brief exposition on Jesus' I am statements.
Yeah.
And his unity with the Lord. And what he's doing as member of the Godhead is he is inviting us into the fellowship within the Godhead.
Yes,
and
amen.
He has the
amen.
Power to do that.
Mm-hmm. That they might be one in us.
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Sister Maddie?
This matter of God would have all men to be saved, but not all men respond. Reminded of what Jesus said when he wept over Jerusalem. He says, how oft would I have gathered you?
Yeah.
He said, but you would not.
That's right.
And so the fault is not with salvation.
Yeah.
The fault is that some men have judged themselves unworthy and they've refused to be a part of this.
And even to them, we've talked about this some, maybe someone here hasn't considered it. He didn't write the Jews off totally. He wrote off a generation of them.
Right. Yeah.
He said, you'll not see me again till you say until you say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. So if the salvation had not been thorough, he couldn't say that.
That's right.
See, he couldn't say that the provision wasn't thorough.
Yeah.
So he's gonna lift the veil from their eyes. It's a generation, and I've told you this before. I reserve the right to be wrong, but I don't think I am. I think we're living in a rejected generation.
Yeah.
I think this generation in our country has been rejected. That there's a remnant. They're not, it's not total any more than when he rejected the Jews. There were a remnant of people. Quite a few of them, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
But I don't know how you can account for the explosion of iniquity apart from God's left the room. I don't know how you can account for this any other way. But you want to be of good cheer that the door of salvation, it hasn't closed the door of salvation.
Right.
Yes.
I greatly enjoy this emphasis on the Father loves the Son, because in seeing how precious Christ is to the Father, he becomes all the more precious to us also.
Yes.
Amen.
Because that's where his love is found.
Yeah.
I mean, the fact that God loves Jesus so much that he will not turn away anyone connected to him.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's an impossibility. If Jesus is in a person, God will not cast him out.
Yeah.
Amen.
So, and that makes him precious to us too. And you can even extend this to what we talked about, the levels, the center, the godly, what have you. Even a space to repent is verified by this death of Jesus. Jesus died for him. And so since that provision for them to be connected to him is made, that makes it just for them to be a space for repentance for every man.
Amen.
Regardless of how long it is, because Jesus made the provision. Because there's a provision for that person to be joined to him, God can give that space.
Yes. You know, if you're confused in any part of your thinking, if you can get hold of this, that the Father loves the Son, if you can really get hold of that, it will eventually straighten out your thinking on things that maybe are confusing to you at this present time.
Yeah.
It will eventually straighten it all out. All right. We'll close for there, but Sister Barb.
Yeah.